Good morning. Welcome to worship here at the Reformed Church of Stout. Just a few announcements for this morning. First of all, we'll start off with a couple sad notes. I'm sure you heard that Mary Vry was killed in an automobile accident this week. So please keep the Vry family in your thoughts and prayers. And then also received word this morning that Kenny DeVries passed away early this morning. So his service is going to be here at the Reformed Church of Stout. So I'll probably send out an email and give you further details on what's going on there. Couple things in our bulletin. The installation ordination service for Kevin Pulliam has had to be postponed. Kevin was exposed to COVID this week, so we have no makeup date, but we're thinking sometime probably in September. Consistory this Thursday night, we're a little bit off on the lunch schedule because we did not have lunch, or we did not have consistory during July, but Brad, you're up, so, you know. Sarah, you're up. Okay. And that's probably for the best. I mean, I'm just speaking for myself. If I would cook, that would probably not be the best. Fall classes is September 14th. So if you'd like to go along either as a delegate or just as a visitor, please let me know so we can get those names turned in. Women's conference is September 7th. September 11th. Oh, how could I forget that day? So thank you, Norma. Norma is kind of the contact person. If you'd like to go or whatever, let her know. Does anyone have anything else this morning? If not, let's stand for our call to worship, our opening prayer, and then we'll have our opening hymn. So let's stand. This verse came up in my devotional this morning. I think it's very fitting for the times that we're going through. From John chapter 16, verse 33. Jesus speaking, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you're going to have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for these words of encouragement from your Son, that we know that no matter how bad things get, your Son has overcome it and that you are in control. This morning, may we leave those earthly things behind for a few moments as we come and worship your name. We thank you for all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our opening hymn number 138, Jesus is the sweetest name I know.
Thank you.
Let's wave to those who are unable to be with us this morning and watching on Facebook. Also, briefly say hello to one another. And then the children, if you want to come forward. With Grandpa this morning. Yeah, it's a pretty good place to be. Well, guys, summer is over, right? Tomorrow's the big day, at least for Dyke New Hartford. I don't know about AP when they start, but so back to school, right? So tell me, what are some things that you might take along with you tomorrow morning as you go back to school, unless you went already and brought some stuff, but pencils. Some pencils, right? Okay. How about it? What's that? Colored pencils, and I don't have any of them, but you're right. Okay. What else? Colors. I heard Grandpa say colors, right? Unless you're really fortunate and you get one of those big boxes with the sharpener in the back. Are those still really awesome, or is that like old-fashioned by now? Everybody going, I don't even know what that is. But yeah, guy, oh, for us that were older, right, if you got that box of 64 with the sharpener in the back, you were uptown. I mean, that was something special. What else? Erasers, okay, we got them on the pencils, unless you were like me and you made a lot of mistakes and you needed the big erasers. How about this? Some glue, right? A ruler, maybe? A rule. Yeah, you're right. It is a rule. It's not a ruler. I should have remembered that. Scissors. Okay. And the last thing I brought along was a notebook, something like this, or maybe you just have a spiral notebook with paper. Okay. What would happen if you'd go to school with absolutely nothing in your backpack tomorrow? It'd be kind of difficult, probably, right? Maybe the teacher would be able to come up with some stuff for you, but those things that we bring to school, we're going to use them, right? The same is true about what we read and learn in the Bible. We can read it, we can have the Bible in our house, but if we leave it at home or we don't use it, it doesn't do us any good, okay? So I hope you guys can remember that this week. As you go back to school and you learn those things that your teachers are going to teach you, which are very, very important, remember it's also important to keep learning about Jesus, okay? Let's pray. Father, we just thank you. Lord, we thank you that our students can go back to school this week. Lord, we just pray that you will bless them, bless their teachers as well. Help them to do well in their studies, Lord, but most of all, help them to always remember that there's someone else that we need to learn about, and that is Jesus. We just thank you for him, and we pray this all in his name. Amen. All right, let's see here. What do I have? Oh my goodness, three kids. Three boxes of some candy. So you can get all revved up this afternoon, but don't be revved up tomorrow at school, okay? I don't want your teacher calling me. All right, you guys can go sit back down. Oh. All right, at this time we're going to have our special music. Don Graves is going to bless us, and the title of his song is He Knows Just What I Need. And Roger, thank you for lining that up this morning.
Your opening prayer this morning really fits into the song that I'm going to sing. So there's, I think, been times and days for all of us. You're okay? There's been times, and I think days for all of us, where we are kind of down in the dumps. Seems like no matter what we do, things just don't turn out right. And maybe even come to a point where we think maybe almost all hope is gone. So during those days, then Jesus knows just exactly what we need. So we'll have the song at this time. Jesus knows when I am lonely, He heals each pain, He sees each tear, He understands.
Going to change things up a little at the Reformed Church of Stout this morning. For our prayer of illumination, I've chosen the hymn number 459, Open Our Eyes. Just remain seated and sing the words, but really think about what they're saying as we come into God's Word at this time.
Mm-hmm.
Our scripture this morning comes from Luke, the second chapter, verses 41 through 52, and it's found on page 1592 in your pew Bibles if you'd like to follow along. The top caption in my Bible says, "The Boy Jesus in the Temple." Every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up to the festival according to the custom. After the festival was over, while his parents were returning home, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but his parents were unaware of it. Thinking that he was with their company, they traveled for a day, and then they began to look for him among the relatives and friends that were traveling with them. When they did not find him, they turned around and went back to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers and listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished, and his mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." "Why were you searching for me?" Jesus asked. "Didn't you know that I had to be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he was saying to them. Then he went down to Nazareth with them in obedience to them. But this his mother treasured in her heart. And Jesus grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and with men. The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God. As I had gotten this message ready and had been working on it, my plan was to focus on the first day of school. But God has a way of changing our plans, let's say. The sight of people on top of an airplane, so desperate to try to get out of a country that is ravished with war, has been imprinted on my mind this past week. Their desperation. As I was doing my study this week with Pastor Petrie at Zion Reformed, he told me that his message this Sunday was going to be "When There Is No Hope in the Hope." We've kind of come to that point, haven't we? There's so much that doesn't make sense in this world. There are so many things that are flying out of control. There are so many questions and very few, if any, answers. In this morning's text, we read that story of Jesus and his family heading to Jerusalem for the festival. Every year. No matter what was going on in your life, no matter how bad things were at home, you went. Was it a custom? Yes. But there was more to it than just being a custom or just being a habit. God wanted to meet with his people. God wanted them to join him in a festival, in a feast, in a time of celebration, leaving the world behind and coming for a few days to focus upon him. We all know the story. We all know that they were there, and when the festival was over, Mary and Joseph and their caravan headed back for home. And somehow Jesus got left behind. Can you imagine today if parents would happen to leave their child behind in a big city and go home without them? That would not be a good thing. But in this instance, we have Jesus, and he's 12 years old. If you know the Jewish culture, at the age of 13, that is the age where a boy becomes a man, and they celebrate that. But Jesus is clearly not a man yet. He is still a boy. And as his parents head back to see if they can find Jesus, they search for 3 days. 3 days. I've mentioned many times when a certain phrase or group of words is mentioned over and over in the Bible, we need to take special note of what it is about. And here it is, 3 days. Mary asked Jesus, "Why did you do this?" And Jesus' answer is simple. He says, "Mom, don't you know I need to be going about my Father's business?" And Jesus wasn't talking about Joseph. And Mary knew that. She didn't totally understand what had happened and what was going on. She had been told by the angel that Jesus was going to be God's son, that he was going to be special, that he would do amazing things. But she didn't totally get it. In verse 40, we read that this child, Jesus, grew up and he was strong. He was filled with wisdom. And that the grace of God was upon him. Jesus, at the age of 12, was no ordinary boy. He had great wisdom. And at this point, I think we should make it very clear that wisdom and knowledge or intelligence are not the same. He was intelligent. He knew the Old Testament prophecies in the Scripture. He often quoted them from memory. We could say he knew his Bible, and he knew it well. But this wasn't the source of his wisdom. Oh, it helped him understand things. It gave him a bigger perspective on what was going on. But Jesus' wisdom came from God himself. And now he is sitting amongst the teachers of the law, the scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees. And with each question that is asked and each answer that is given and the input that Jesus gives to the conversation, these men who are well-schooled, these men that are supposed to have all the answers, are sitting there dumbfounded. They cannot believe what they are hearing. The wisdom that Jesus is sharing, let alone the fact that he's only 12 years old. I can't help but wonder if some of those teachers of the law that day had to wonder, what is this guy all about? At this point in time, I don't believe they feel as though Jesus is someone to be scared of, someone that may take their power away or their thunder away. But I still believe in the back of their mind, they got to wonder, who is this kid anyway? Some might have wondered, I wonder where he's getting his schooling. He must have a great school with great facilities. He has to have good teachers. Maybe he's homeschooled. Where has he learned all this? Back to verse 40, the last part of that verse we read, that the grace of God was upon him. These are the same words that John was described by in chapters 1 and verse 80. The grace of God was upon him. Jesus had found favor with God, his heavenly Father. And in this showering of grace, Jesus is listening. He's learning. He's soaking it all in. This past week, two weeks ago, as we were on our little trip, we had our devotion together, and I was going to ask you this before, and now I'm going to put you on the spot. Because I can't remember the exact wording, and if we can't, we'll move on. But they described fear, right? Do you remember what that said? Fear is not being scared of God, but being scared of not being with God, I believe is kind of what the gist of it was. God. So not being scared of God as far as what's happening in your life, but being scared of being separated from Him. Jesus and God were one, and that's where He found His favor. Proverbs 9 verse 10 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding." Jesus understood those words fully, and He lived them out completely. But on the flip side of that, in Proverbs, it also gives this warning in Proverbs 1:7. "The fear of the Lord is beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and discipline." Here, the scripture makes another distinction between knowledge and wisdom. It's obedience. And that's the second part of my message, obedience. We know that Jesus lived that perfect life, right? No sin. Even in the face of all that temptation in the desert, He conquered it. But Jesus was more than just obedient. Jesus didn't just listen to the law. He lived it out every day of His life. He walked the walk. In verse 49 of our text, Jesus says these words, "Don't you know that I had to be in my Father's house?" Jesus wasn't being snotty. He wasn't being disrespectful to His mother. He was stating a fact. He was saying to Mary and to the world, "This is what I need to be doing." It is the first reference of Jesus' awareness and acknowledgement that He knew that He was God's Son. Jesus was saying without a shadow of a doubt, "I am God's Son. He has sent me here for a specific purpose, and I need to live it out." If you notice in verse 51, though, even though He was totally obedient to His heavenly Father, He also was obedient to His earthly mom and dad. I think sometimes we get that in our mindset that if we are followers of God, that means that we don't have to follow the rules that are here upon the earth. And that's not true. If we follow God in perfect obedience, then the rules and the regulations that are here upon this earth will be rather easy for us to follow. And it won't be in disobedience to God. Finally, in this text, we read that this wisdom of Jesus had a great impression upon the people. Strike that. It had a lasting impression. People who saw Jesus, people who heard Jesus, they were different after that. They went away with something that was burning inside them. The last part of verse 51. "But Mary treasured all these things in her heart." There's that repeating of the same words again. We read it in Luke chapter 2, right? After the shepherds had come and visited Jesus, we read that Mary pondered all those things in her heart. This does not mean that Mary had all the answers. If we live this life thinking we have to have all the answers, we're not going to find them. If we live that life in that desire, in that focus, "I need the answers, I need the answers, I got to dig, I got to find the answers," we're wasting our time. Only God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, can give us the answers. And He is only going to give us His answers in His time. It doesn't mean that we never read our Bible. It doesn't mean that we don't have Bible studies, that we don't try to learn more about Jesus and about the gospel. But what it does mean is that we're not trying to do it on ourselves. Jesus made an impression that day. He impressed His parents. He impressed His mother. Now, frankly, we as parents are a bit biased, aren't we? I mean, if our kids does a little something good or says something rather full of wisdom, we think, wow, kids got it together. Fairly easily, we might say that. But Jesus impressed these leaders, these people who knew the law inside out, upside down, backwards, forwards. They knew it in any sense that was possible. But the common man as well was impressed with the knowledge and the wisdom that Jesus had. But they were impressed in a different way. I don't believe they were impressed with the fact that Jesus could rattle out Scripture word upon word, verse upon verse, without having a scroll in front of him. They weren't impressed with the fact that Jesus could keep up with the leaders of the day. What they were impressed with was Jesus' humbleness and his kindness and love as he spoke those words, as he shared those words, and as I said before, as he lived them out. This, in fact, was Jesus' first day in school. But he wasn't just learning, he was teaching. He was probably doing more teaching than learning, but even in this setting, I believe he was taking it all in. He was becoming more like his Father. Do we have that wisdom today, or are we simply striving to get knowledge? Book smarts, we might call it. In this world where there seems to be very little common sense, we might say, are we seeking to have common sense? And again, don't get me wrong, having book smarts and having common sense, that's important. We need to do that. We need to keep learning each and every day. But ultimately, God is longing for us to have wisdom that only He can give. That fear of Him, that healthy fear. When Colton came in this morning, I asked him if he was ready for school, and he said, or Kelton, not really, or something like that, I think, right? As boys, I think that's kind of common for us. We really don't look forward to going back to school. We'd rather stay at home on the farm or wherever we may be. But if we seek God's wisdom, then every day of school in our lives will be a good day. We'll look forward to it. And when we see those images that are on the news that are upsetting or troubling, concerning, yes, even scary, we'll know that God is still in control. And that even through those things, I believe God is teaching us or trying to teach us something. As we go out this week, as there will be funerals of people that we know, as there will be the continuing lack of rainfall for this earth in this area, as we see things on TV, as we hear more statistics about COVID, as I can go on and on. Those things are very real. Those things are causing issues in our lives. It's how we respond to them that matters. And next week, we'll look at this a little bit further as we turn our eyes upon Jesus. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you for this time. Thank you for this scripture portion that teaches us how Jesus became wise beyond his years. It was because of you. And Lord, we now have that perfect example to look upon, your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, may we want to learn more about him each and every day. It is in his name that we pray. Amen. Our hymn of application this morning is Tell Me the Stories of Jesus, number 205. Let's stand while we sing. One of the things we know from the story of Jesus is that he wants us to come to him with those things that are upon our heart. If you have the prayer concern flyer in your bulletin, you can see those that are listed. I've added the Mary Fry family, the Kenny DeVries family, the situation in Afghanistan and in Haiti, and also our students and teachers and college kids as they go back for another year of continuing education. Does anyone have anything else that should be added or you'd like to have lifted up? If not, let's come before our God and let's pray to him. Father, again, we understand that you have given us this avenue of prayer through your Son, Jesus Christ, a time that we can come before you, that we can pour it all out at your feet. Lord, as we were singing that song, those words of all the things that Jesus went through, all the troubles, the trials, the pain, the anguish that he went through, it reminded us of many things that are going on in the lives of people that we know and love very dearly. But Lord, before we lift them up, the words of that song went on and continued that we know that Jesus died, that he was buried, but praise be to your name that he liveth again, that he overcame it all, and that we too can be assured of that, that even through these trials, these tragedies, these things that hurt us so much, Jesus will see us through, and in the end, we will be more than conquerors because he loved us. Father, we come before you this morning and we pray for the Fry family. Lord, that family has had a lot of heartache upon this earth, many things that have been so sad and heartbreaking for them, and now another tragedy. Lord, I just pray that you will be with that family, that you would wrap your arms of love and concern and compassion around them, that you, through this terrible event, would bring them closer to you. Lord, we think of the DeVries family as well. Lord, we just pray that as this week unfolds and as the funeral and the different things that need to happen, Lord, we just pray that you will be there through all that. Lord, we think of people who have it off so much worse than we do. We think of the people in Afghanistan, Lord, especially those who love you and are worshiping you. Lord, we know that their lives, their little physical life, is in great danger, that some probably already have been murdered for your cause. Lord, protect those that are still there. Lord, we praise you for those that stood strong, even though it meant that they would lose their life. What a witness that has been. For the people of Haiti, Lord, who have suffered an earthquake and have been bombarded with weather events as well. Lord, just be with them. Lord, we think of our students and our teachers as they go back to school. Lord, I just pray that you will bless each and every one of them. Lord, may you keep them safe, especially in this time of COVID. Lord, we pray too for our college students as they go back. Lord, we just pray that as they are away from home, as they are away from this church, that you would protect them physically, yes, but even more, Lord, may you keep them safe in their walk with you. Lord, as they are bombarded with half-truths or things that have no truth to them at all, may they know that the truth lies in your word and in that alone. Lord, we just pray for those who continue to struggle with cancer and other things. Lord, we just pray that you would heal them if it be your will, but more of all, would you encourage them? Will you give them guidance in everything that they need to decide? Lord, we think especially of Anna. We just pray that you will bless her. As some things have shown up in her recent tests, Lord, we just pray that the doctors may figure out what is going on. And Lord, we just pray that they may have a plan, a solution for those things as well. Lord, we just pray that you will be also with our food pantry, Lord. We just pray that you will continue to bless it here in this community and in the surrounding areas. Lord, we pray too for the Reformed Church of Stout. Lord, as Fall has arrived as our fall programs will begin. We just pray that you will bless them. May we teach our student the truths of your word. Lord, we pray especially for our kids' time activities that we may, if it be your will, find more kids that would be willing and wanting to come. Lord, we thank you for all these wonderful things. Lord, we thank you too again for our shut-ins. We just pray that you will be especially close to them. Lord, they are a shining example of what faith in you is all about. Lord, as I visit with them, that is the one thing that comes up over and over, is how strong their faith is in you. And Lord, that comes only through you, and I praise you for it. Lord, I lastly pray for this, the United States of America, once again. Lord, may we put our differences aside, and may we be united as we once were. May we come before you and acknowledge that you are the leader that we need to follow. May we not be so concerned about our party's affiliation. Lord, may we not even be so concerned about the financial situation or the political situation that we are concerned about, but may we be most and foremost concerned about doing your will. Lord, I thank you for those that serve this country in many ways, for our troops that are serving, for our veterans that have served, for the many who each and every day put their life out there to protect us and to serve us. We thank you for that. Lord, and I thank you this morning for your holy word. May we dig into it daily. May we seek the wretches that are there. And may we, in fact, live them out just as your Son, Jesus Christ, did. And Lord, now we pray that prayer that he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God indeed has enriched us with his blessings, both physical and spiritual. At this time, let's stand for our doxology and our prayer of offering of thanksgiving. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Before you with thankful hearts. We come before you with amazed hearts, Lord. As over and over I've heard people say, I can't believe how good the crops look despite the lack of rainfall. And Lord, even for those of us that aren't farmers, for those of us that have other occupations, Lord, you have blessed us so richly beyond compare, even though we don't deserve it. And we thank you for that. May we always remember that all we have comes from your good grace. And Lord, we return now that portion that you have set upon our hearts. Bless it and multiply it to the furtherance of your kingdom in Jesus' name. Amen. Our hymn of closing is Open My Eyes That I May See, number 461.
Thank you.
And now as we leave this place, may our eyes be fully focused on you, our Savior, the Son of the Most and Holy God. And all God's people said, Amen. Our closing chorus is, I Will Serve Thee, number 469.